Live from the FIA Barcelona Gran Via Conference Center in Barcelona, Spain, it's theCUBE at HP Discover Barcelona 2014. Brought to you by headline sponsor HP. Here are your hosts, John Furrier and Dave Vellante.
Welcome back, everyone. We are here live in Barcelona for HP Discover 2014. This is theCUBE, our flagship program. We go out to the event, extract the signal from the noise. I'm John Furrier, my co-host Dave Vellante, and our next guest, Mark Interrante, Senior Vice President of Engineering for the HP Helion Cloud Group. Welcome back to theCUBE.
Thanks, good to be here.
You know, we're all from California, so we're all kind of like, they're dead, like, what a wall. But Helion is pumping right now. You guys have a great momentum. We chatted our last conversation. And we saw each other in San Francisco at the big party you guys had with OpenStack. Great success across the board. You're seeing the marching of the team, more investment. You guys are contributing a lot to OpenStack. And now you had a new leader in Martin Mikos. He looked a little nervous up there in the keynote, but he's just playing cool. I'm proud to be here, humble. What's it like? What's going on? Tell us, give us the update.
Oh boy, yeah. To me, we're really excited because we delivered Helion. This is, you know, we built this out for many, many months, and it's very exciting to actually get a full release delivered along with the development environment all set up. We're onboarding customers onto it. We're getting really good feedback, and the conversations we've had with the customers here have been quite exciting, and people are really, you know, pushing us to get more features added in and to build out the system.
So the first question I want to ask you is, what's going on internally? Because we've been chronicalizing the evolution of the cloud group from the rubbing nickels together and then SAR taking it over, you know, getting things going, and now that really is bulked up. What's going on inside HP? Are you guys servicing other organizations? Because the converged stuff is going great, storage is moving great. Yep. There's a lot of technology sharing. So you're the engineering guy. So yeah. What are you guys building in the cloud group, and what are you sharing back, or can you help us
understand? Sure, well we're sharing everything. We're totally about open source. But we're partnering very closely. I'm looking at converged systems. We're partnering with the networking team. So what we do is we realize, or we talk about, where do we want networking to go? We want all these new features in Neutron and Nova and things like that. So we're like, okay, well, how do we go achieve this over the next 3, 6, 9 months? And so I work with my peers, and we're figuring out, okay, you do this, I do that. And the networking guys are just profoundly deep in software-defined networking skills, and my team doesn't have a lot of those. We've got more distributed system skills, so they team up and write certain areas, I write other areas. And so that's a big part of it right now, is we're really trying to broaden it from just the cloud BU writing the code to many of us all collaborating.
So you guys have had great growth on the number of contributors at OpenStack. You guys do a lot. I mean, yeah, I think at 30, 40 people at one point. I don't know what the numbers are. It's growing, but I mean,
what do you ask about committers? I'm sorry.
What are the numbers?
You say committers or
engineers. Well, I'm trying to understand how many people are engineering pure open source,
yes,
versus engineers, like internal normal engineers at HP working on HP stuff. Oh, are they separated? Are they categorized that way?
No, they're not really categorized. We've got developers that are working on the compute infrastructure. Some of them for a period of months are going to be working on a feature, an element that we care about, so it may not be as upstream. Other folks are going to be working on a pure upstream work. So we don't believe in kind of sorting people out into different categories like that. We're all engineers. We're all working on these distributed systems.
How do you decide which goes open source? Is there more like a Google model where 20% of your time is towards open source, or is there people full throttle on?
Our principles are that basically anything that is practical goes open source. But there's certain things that kind of aren't, because it's relative to like a piece of our firmware or something like that. It doesn't really make sense. Or it doesn't make sense to have something that's outside of OpenStack. It's like, we're not trying to push stuff in OpenStack that doesn't belong.
Okay, so when you say you're totally open source,
yep,
you mean any contributions you make to OpenStack, obviously.
Yep, yes.
Cinder drivers for fiber channel,
yes,
open source.
Absolutely. Yeah,
stuff you do in networking for Neutron,
yes,
open source.
Yep.
Okay, so
our control panels are Horizon. We're contributing SDKs into the open source SDKs that exist. We're trying to help make those better and be good members of those communities.
So as a customer of Helion, I'm basically buying into an open source platform.
Yes, that's right.
And like you said, some stuff maybe is not, because it's...
Yeah, there's not much. Some of it doesn't make sense
underneath
yet.
The covers, and nobody would care if you open sourced it.
Exactly.
So compare that other clouds out there? I mean, is there a spectrum, or is it just like closed, open?
Well, certainly there's a set of really awesome closed clouds, right, where you get the API and you've got their world.
That's Amazon.
Yeah, Amazon.
There's an API, everything else.
All that stuff, yeah, exactly.
We take from open source, we don't give much back. Okay.
Yeah, that's right.
That's their call. Right.
And that's a great business model.
Okay, and then you're at the other end.
We are.
Which is totally open, except for a couple things that nobody cares about being open.
And then I think there's some things in the middle. And I'm not completely familiar with all the company's internal open source strategies, but you could easily say, look, we're based on open source. Like, I use Nova, I use Swift. But we had a ton of bits around that that's proprietary. So you build your own.
Or we're using Cloud Foundry as a PaaS layer. Yes, exactly.
Okay, all right. So there's a spectrum. And look, we come down to the fact that we believe being a member of the community, putting as much stuff upstream as possible, is a high value to us.
Is this a cultural shift for HP? I mean, HP's always been open.
Yeah.
But in terms of open source software, is this relatively new? I mean, I know Linux has been something that you contributed to.
I'm sensing a
greater emphasis on open source in the last three years.
There is a greater emphasis. I'm relatively new to HP, so I don't know all of the last decade of history. But if you go back even further, go back into the 80s, massive members of the Unix community, the Open Software Foundation, and different communities like that. So they've been very involved in Unix and the evolution to Linux for a very long time. But now, in the last couple of years, there's been a really big focus around open source contribution and just open source as a way to build software that's in deep internet infrastructure.
So from the standpoint of managing an engineering team, what does that mean? How is it different? And it kind of touches on John's question. And how do you leverage that open source community and versus your internal resources? And how do you allocate those? Or how do you predict how much the open source contribution's really going to deliver that you might not have to invest in internal?
Well, no, that's the key thing, is how the predictability does go down. And now, look, closed source software is not very predictable either, right? But at least everybody is on your team, and all of what you're doing is yours.
You can order them around.
You can encourage people to
encourage them. Do this by Friday. They're going to yell at you.
But when it's open source and you're teaming up with a dozen other people or dozens of other people, you know, you're not sure if this is going to land in March or May, depending on how the project goes. And if it's kind of halfway done in March, I'm not shipping it. So what we have is less predictability of any individual feature, but the overall aggregate velocity, I believe, is far superior. Because the number and the kind of people that we're having on these projects are people you just can never bring into one company. There's networking people from a variety of awesome networking companies. There's hypervisor experts that, you know, you couldn't assemble the OpenStack community under one roof.
So is the aggregate velocity predictable?
Yeah, you could say we're going to get about X interesting features per quarter.
I don't know exactly what's going to hit when.
You can kind of predict at some level, but these features will probably land, other ones probably won't.
So there's a little bit of art in there from managing the team standpoint.
And an open source project, sometimes projects wander a bit. You know, a new project kicks up. It may explore a couple of different options before it kind of hones in on this is what it's really about.
Right.
And that may mean some predictability in the middle of the project before it actually releases.
And you can inject resources into the open source model, right? So guys, get on this.
Absolutely.
Accelerate turn those knobs.
So for example, in the last 6-9 months, we really wanted to contribute more into Neutron, the networking project. Mm-hmm. And we significantly upped our Neutron contributions. We brought people in, we found people that were interested in this work, and we got them engaged on it. And that really, I think, helped stabilize and increase the quality and the throughput of Neutron in this last Juno release. Mm-hmm.
Mark, I gotta ask you, so getting back to kind of the ethos, because, you know, we love open source, we're a media version of OpenStack with the way we do our content. Everything's free. We believe that you release stuff free, good stuff happens, and, you know, whether it's CrowdCheck gets some momentum, that's the kind of thing we believe in. So we're with you on that. So I got to ask you the question, the big butt, and the plug. The big butt is, how do you explain to folks out there how you're successful with open source? I know Martin is obviously involved. You have a lot of great people on the board. HP has good culture with open source, good alignment there. But how do you manage the successful transition to shipping product
in an open source framework. A lot of companies are trying, and they say they want to do it, don't know how to. There's no real, you know, how to play with open source for dummies book. Maybe there is, but what is the secret to your success, and what are your challenges, and how do you manage that?
That's a great question. So I think some of the challenges are that the code evolves rather quickly, and it has stability areas. So any 6 month releases for OpenStack, it's most stable in about a month or two during that release, because after that you're adding more stuff in and it becomes a bit less stable as you're adding new features in. So you've got to understand the dynamics of OpenStack. And I've been lucky enough to be having been in OpenStack for 4 years now, and so been I think released everything since Essex.
It's kind of like an organism. You kind of know when you inject new, you know, something's a reaction, and you got to have a feeling for it.
Yeah, absolutely.
A cadence, if you will.
There is a cadence. There's certain points where you kind of get a feeling that, look, the code is going to be more stable around a month or so after the big release.
So I guess the question is kind of like the entrepreneurial question. Are you born with that inherent skill, or you learn it?
You can totally learn it.
Okay.
And so there's no magic there. In fact, we're happy to share this kind of stuff we've learned, because I think it just helps make everybody's products better.
So what do you guys do? What's the secret besides the cadence?
So cadence,
hiring?
Hire people that love open source. I hire people that both have software development experience and an online services experience. So myself, for example, I built software. I've also run services, like, for example, at Yahoo, which have a continuous integration, continuous delivery model. So we do continuous.
And you can get on the back channel and rip someone apart and say, hey, fix your code done. Look at the IRC channels.
We love the IRC channels.
Yeah, online collaboration, too.
Oh, my. We are very much in IRC. So, and we've got all kinds of different channels for different projects. If I ever want to go, hey, guys, what's going on, or where are we here, I just hop on the channel and see where things are. And it's a very distributed team. We're in half a dozen countries, and we're in many locations in the U.S., so it's highly virtual.
So you got your budgets for 2015.
Yep.
How'd it look? You guys investing more?
Hiring? We're absolutely investing more. I'm actively hiring folks. So if you're out there and you want to do some great work on open source and work in OpenStack, come talk to me.
So what areas are you looking at specifically? Obviously, up and down the stack, or is there any focus areas that you're hot on? You're zoomed in like a laser on.
Well, I've kind of OpenStack experience around Nova Swift, Neutron, Glance, absolutely in those areas. The other thing I'm a big believer in is really great user experiences, great UIs. So we're investing in good
design.
Design. Investing in design and UX.
Yeah, no one's giving up the names on those. They're hard to hire right now.
They are hard to hire. They're hard to hire.
Oh, well, once the bubble burst. No,
about it. Well, and I think generally, I have a belief in high quality internet grade UIs coming out of Yahoo, like I said, so that's really what I look for. Most people have done that.
So I got to ask the technical questions now around, and then strategy questions, if you will, just in engineering around NFV. So we were talking with Saar earlier. NFV's got his new business unit over there. Huge telco opportunity. Really perfectly fit for OpenStack, right? So you actually got Amazon, you got Google out there with their own clouds. They're not going to be really kind of warming up to the telcos anytime soon. So that's pretty obvious for the people who know their business strategy. Almost direct competitive. OpenStack seems like a great fit.
I think it's awesome.
So what's going on with NFV? Who writes what code? Are you writing that code? Is it all open source? I mean, when I say you, I mean, is the Helion cloud team doing it?
So I think
Saar just integrating everything together.
No, Saar's got development teams. I have development teams. Saar and I are collaborating, going like, he needs certain things built. He needs OpenStack to evolve in certain ways. Well,
for NFV, for his customers, and his telco customers.
For his kind of cases, and we'll go get those people in, and we'll find, okay, here's how we can help Nova evolve in a specific way. And it's more natural for us to do that work than for him to bring some people in from outside. There's lots of things about VNFs, virtual functions, and things like that are much more natural for his team to go focus on.
Great.
So we're really trying to harden and make OpenStack more fit for purpose for those kind of telcos.
So what do you guys talk about in your management meetings? When you're sitting in there as execs, you're sitting around the table, you know, relaxed, having a good time. What's on the agenda? What do you guys talk about the most? Is it hiring? Is it market penetration?
It's customer. First thing is customers. So we're talking about, you know, who's had what customer success, what are we hearing from the people we're talking to. All of the executive team is very, very into that, including myself and my leaders also. Second thing is, like, where are certain projects? How are we getting things done? How are we looking at upcoming releases? And how are we prioritizing our work? Those are probably the two main things.
And how about growth? You guys talk about, you know, objectives and hitting your targets, like growth targets. And you guys talk about growth numbers and stuff?
We do, yeah. And so...
You can share some of that.
Stays in the vault.
Kind of does. I can't talk too much about that. No, we're growing very rapidly. We're excited about both the Helion growth areas and the cloud system. And it's, you know, it's startup growth rates, which is nice to see.
So Meg wants velocity, right?
Yes.
You got a budget, good budget, but it's not unlimited.
Yep.
So I wonder if you could talk a little bit about sort of where you're putting your effort. I mean, you got some references out there. You said customers are really what's driving. What are they asking for? I mean, there's a good reference model, obviously, in the public cloud.
Yep.
You know, you got to have an object store, you got to have a compute, you got to have a block store, you got to have networking, whatever it is. But what are really the priorities? You know, talk roadmap a little bit if you can.
Okay, so I think a couple of things. So one, we want to get it to our public cloud scale. So right now, as we built Helion, we built it. The first target set of cases is more for the private cloud scale and private cloud capacity.
Mm-hmm.
So as we're building in more and more features and capabilities to make it a carrier grade or service provider level offering, there's things that you would need if you were managing tens of thousands of machines that you don't need if you're managing at a more private cloud scale.
That are related to management and automation?
Management, automation,
orchestration.
Just bring, for example, when you're at a public cloud scale, you're bringing in racks of machines every week or every day in some cases, right? So I mean, so literally all the pre-certification, how do you connect that new capacity in, certify that it's good, make sure that it's effective before you turn it on? There's a ton of automation you can do just right there. It's stuff that, if you're running a private cloud of many hundreds of nodes, you may add capacity once a quarter, twice a year.
Is it requiring you guys to engineer sort of more custom hardware that you can't necessarily get from HP off the shelf?
Not yet.
No, okay. Do you think it will? Going forward mega scale?
I've been pretty impressed by the variety of hardware we offer, actually. I'm becoming more and more aware of that.
Uh-huh.
But, you know, we have our cloud line, we have our SL and DL lines. The cloud line is really optimized for, minimum footprint, maximum compute per power. And so it's very similar to what public cloud providers
do. So let me ask that differently, because years ago people would say, oh, public cloud guys, they just use white boxes and Seagate disk drives and that's it. And that's changed.
Yes.
So, and you've got a big portfolio to choose from. So, you're not building this just on, or are you, on white boxes and off-the-shelf disk drives?
We're building it on HP gear.
Yeah, so,
okay. So
the full spectrum.
The full spectrum,
okay, gear. And then, so the challenge is how do you get scale with that diversity, right?
Yeah, so a part of that, maybe that's more of a public cloud kind of question.
Yes, absolutely.
So, you know, we get good discounts from our HP partners, and the CL line is quite cost-effective, which is really based on the Foxconn kind of open designs. And so they're designed around not having the extra chips you don't need if you're only running a cloud offering. So that just seems to work pretty well.
So kind of an open reference model that you guys can use that they can build to it.
That's right, yeah. And then part of what we think, we're trying to make Helion work the best on HP gear, so that, I mean, we're trying to make HP gear safe. And there's additional features and support within HP gear that we think we can be very very fast and effective in building out those products.
I always use I live in an old house, so I use the old house analogy. You guys obviously you and many of your competitors, going after a hybrid cloud strategy. And anytime you do anything to an old house, you got to connect it, the new to the old, and that's the hardest part.
Yes.
So I wonder if you could talk about that. Is that a challenge in the cloud land? And how do you get around those challenges?
I think it's a lot of features that we are building in, have built into Helion 1, and we're going to be building in the future versions of Helion that make it more easier to interconnect. A couple of things we shipped in version 1, Active Directory Sync, Active Directory integration for Keystone, making it very easy to manage your users. We have ESX support for that hypervisor. We're trying to be very open to the very common, very popular enterprise technologies so we can integrate into them very effectively.
That's a challenge, though,
in terms of
getting to scale,
yes.
Right? Isn't that because you get so much diversity in your customer base? Are you, talk about,
go ahead. But we're, I mean, we're building a lot of things for private clouds, much more than a public cloud scale. That's not the only target here.
Yeah, yeah, no, sure, right, yeah. Right. But that was sort of the next wave, right, of challenges. How do we get to scale,
yes,
that public cloud scale?
Right.
And obviously you want to do that so you can get, you know, the marginal economics go to zero or close to zero as possible.
Right.
And do you have to get there, though, and can you with that diversity, or do you not have to because you have an install base that will consume that diversity?
Well, I think two things. One, we want to get to a larger scale for two reasons. One, for ourselves, for our offerings. Two, we have many partners and customers that want to offer Helion clouds, either private cloud, very large private clouds, or public clouds for themselves. So there's a number of different cases for running it at a much larger scale. Mm-hmm.
All right, so the next year, what's your outlook? We have a couple minutes left. Going forward, you got good momentum. You guys have done great. I know you guys worked hard, been following your guys' moves. Great stuff. We're really excited to see that. Now, what's next? It's still going to get harder. It's like the journey just begins with funding. You got funding. You always had funding. But like when you get more,
yes,
it's just more gas for the rocket fuel.
I mean, I think the next set of challenges are how do we execute, you know, multiple simultaneous projects and initiatives. Really, a lot of this year is a Helion getting integrated into more and more parts of the HP business streams. And so in that case, we're getting more integrated with the many of the different hardware systems you see here. And that means we need to sync up with their schedules and their goals and their overall integrations. So I think that's a big challenge.
So new customers too from that. You're
going
to get new customers.
Yes.
Talk about the community, because one of the things that you guys have to also win on is building a community around Helion Cloud.
Yes.
That's a challenge, right? I mean, there's a community out there. You got to win them.
Yes.
Win them over, ingratiate in, grow with them. What's the plan there? What's any visibility on that? You have input on that?
I don't have much visibility into it. The main part that I do focus on is, you know, is OpenStack application developers and getting more and more of those people trained up to be able to use our infrastructure and our development environment. And I think that'll be a big growth area for us in the next.
Which developers would you think, if you could put together the top three list of wish list of genie in the bottle kind of thing,
yeah,
where for your business success to be successful, aligning with, what are the top three developer categories?
I think getting good, strong enterprise developers who are very used to Java and .NET. Having them start to use our platform as we roll it out into their enterprise, I think that's a huge deal for us. Second thing is for those SaaS, ISVs, they're transitioning their software into either an ISV on the cloud or a SaaS model. We want to make sure we're supporting them very, very well. And I would stop.
What's
right
the profile of those guys?
There's a pretty
Python, is it across the board, C++?
That's one of the challenges. It's a pretty wide profile. There's a lot of people that are doing stuff in C++, actually. And so, and it's not typically cloud-oriented. So helping them re-architect with queuing systems and databases on demand.
So integrated stacks, basically, DevOps stuff.
Exactly, yeah.
Okay, so DevOps, so you're probably looking at Node.
Absolutely,
Node would be a good one.
Yes.
Python maybe for data management and wrangling. Okay, cool. Just wanted to kind of get the sense of that, because, you know, something we think about, we talk about all the time, around DevOps.
Yes.
And then you got, you know, the old school. If you're over 40 like me, close to 50, then you know Java.
Yes.
If you're under 40, you don't do Java. Well, I mean, that's my general. That's my opinion.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know, young kids like, Java, that's for old people.
Yeah. No, and I'm very excited about the DevOps movement. I think it's evolving quite rapidly, and it's an area where we're trying to continue to help enable the software developers to control their own infrastructure.
Mark, really appreciate you coming on. I know you're tired, busy all the time. Certainly, jet lag coming from California, we both flew out.
Yeah.
So, and you guys, I know how hard you guys do the customer meetings. So, thanks for spending some time on theCUBE, giving us the update on the engineering front. Final word, I'll give you the word. Quick summary of the difference between Paris Show, OpenStack Summit, and North America. Was there a distinct difference between the two?
So I got to tell you, I didn't actually go to Paris. I missed my first summit ever.
Oh, boy.
I was bummed by it, sprained my ankle, couldn't go. So I got to get back to Vancouver.
So, you can't comment. Okay.
I wish I could, and I wish I was there.
We heard more telco, smaller attendance, very focused.
Very focused. A lot of new people. There's a lot of new people. I think the European audience really had not, people hadn't traveled over to the U.S. to attend. A lot of NFV conversations, and then a lot of good conversation about the enterprise upgradability and modifiability of Nova and Neutron.
I heard great traction in getting new people in, the growing community, so awesome. Thanks for coming on theCUBE. Mark, the Senior Vice President of OpenStack within HP Cloud. Not OpenStack, Senior Vice President of Engineering at HP Helion Cloud. I'm talking about OpenStack here on theCUBE. I'm John Furrier with Dave Vellante. We'll be right back after this short break.
Cool, thank you.